Hello again. As you can hear, I have not been fired by Letizia yet. Let's have a look at some more community questions that were either interesting or caused some confusion within the answers. So, for the first questions, opinions were divided. Most of you actually think that the gradients of individual pixels show you something useful, the gradients regarding the output, that is. What was meant here was simple. Take, for example, a classifier that gets an image and predicts a cat. We now want to know what does the network actually look at. For that, we simply get the gradient of each individual pixel regarding the output. That is, we see how much the output actually changes if we slightly change a pixel's value. In theory, that may sound great, but the information of a single pixel can be somewhat deceiving. Simple arguments against something like that, at least in our opinion, would be, for example, what adversarial attacks do. There, you also look at pixels and see how you want to change those pixels to have a network predict a different class. As a result, a really tiny disturbance can already cause a totally different classification. Simple pixel information seems to be very unstable and not super reliable, at least for many cases where I personally have looked at that. And there are actual papers that look at that too. These examples here compute simple gradients for each pixel regarding the output class that has been produced, showing what is important to produce this label for the image. As you can see, this is super noisy and often pixels on the object itself are not even the most important ones. Like for example for the camera, the lens is actually not important in this visualization. A more refined solution is what they suggest instead. Compute the gradient not just for one single pixel and its current color, but integrate over the gradient of differently blended versions of the image. For example, blending from black to the actual image. And that then gets rid of some of the noise and produces something that is more stable. For example, if we now look at the camera again, we can now see that the lens actually seems to help in the classification and seems to be important for that. If you want to know more about this, you can find the integrated gradients paper and a great distal article with more on that topic in the description box below. Similar to the last question, this one also aims at better understanding what a neural network actually does internally. Consider, for example, a classifier for images again. We then look at our single examples and split them in two different groups by some characteristics, and we do that splitting in the deeper layers of the network. For example, we split the dataset in images with and without water in the background. Now, the normal of that hyperplane that splits our data in the latent space is now actually a direction in which we can move an image representation, for example, in this case, to make it more or less watery, in the sense of what the network actually perceives. And we can now use that to even measure how important that water is for a classification result. We can compute the gradient of this direction with respect to the output of the network. Through that, we see how the output of the classifier actually changes if we move a sample in the latent space along that hyperplane normal. That is how the output changes if we make an image more or less watery. For example, for the ship class, we should see that making an image more or less watery should have an impact on the classifier output, as I've been told that ships usually are in water and thus it's a good cue to be used for the class label. And coming back to the initial question, we can also measure that way how important, for example, a text label is in an image for the resulting classification. And this is great, for example, to see if your network just cheats on a task by abusing some, for example, text labels that have been hard-coded in the image. A paper that looks at all of that in depth, called TCAV, and that tries to measure that and quantify that in some way, is linked below. It's a really interesting and well-written paper that gives you a lot of new ways to view at what a network does internally and how we can actually put that to numbers. We then had two questions about vector quantized variational autoencoders. While those don't sound that exciting, remember that they enable for a great deal of things like DALI. In principle, a VQ-VAE is an autoencoder where the latent space is quantized. That is, you encode some input, then round that latent code to the closest codebook value, and then decode that discretized value to obtain the original input again. This learned discrete representation then works a bit better for some tasks because you can more easily use, for example, transformers on it that are built for discrete inputs. Also, some things in the real world, like words or handwritten digits, are just discrete, so it comes more naturally to express them through a discrete representation. Now, this codebook that we are using to discretize the encoder output is also learned during training, which means that for the loss function, we now have the original reconstruction loss, just as for a normal boring autoencoder, and two parts to regularize the latent space to better fit the values of the codebook, while also moving the used codebook items closer to the samples. If we now just drop that vector quantization part, namely those two extra losses that adapt the codebook to the latent codes and the latent codes to the codebook, all that's left is the autoencoder reconstruction loss. And without that discretization, well, we then just have a plain old autoencoder. And that also means that we no longer get the properties similar to a variational autoencoder, namely a nice and tidy latent through using this codebook. Similar to that question before, look at what happens if we make the codebook of a VQ-VAE infinitely large. For the loss functions, remember that we take our encoded image and then quantize that to the nearest codebook values before we decode that. Now there are two possible interpretations of that questions that largely depend on the initial distribution of the, let's assume one dimensional here, codebook and the initial distribution of the latent. First of all, if we say that an infinite codebook would actually mean a codebook with all possible code words in it, then we would have all the possible numbers our encoder could come up with in there. If that's the case, then both the losses would become zero. If every latent part is actually in the codebook, then we would not need to move our codebook closer to the encoder output or move the output of the encoder closer to the codebook. And as a result, these terms are always zero and we just have a regular old boring autoencoder. And that is what I was actually going for with this question. But as the comments pointed out, that's not the only possible interpretation. For the other possible interpretation, let's say that our infinite codebook has a certain distribution, for example having numbers from minus 1 to 1. If our encoder luckily falls into that range and we stay there, great, we are not going to have any quantization related losses that are non-zero. But if we produce an encoding that gets out of that range, things get a little bit hairy. If we have a value outside that range, say smaller than minus 1, we move that value that comes out of the encoder towards minus 1 by moving the codebook entry with minus 1 towards that actual value. However, we just move that one entry from the boundary there, not touching any of the other values in the codebook for now, as the codebook is only adapted for those code words that are actually used. So now we have a codebook that has some values being quantized and some not being quantized. And over the iterations, that will just spread out and we'd, for example, end up with something like this. We have a core dense region between minus 1 and 1, where quantization doesn't do anything because all the values are in that codebook, and then there's a region where we just regularly discretize. So, this will eventually act like a regular autoencoder for anything inside minus 1 and 1, and like a regular VQ-VAE outside of that, which is somewhat weird. Can you come up with a useful scenario for that, or do you even think that we overlooked something and we get an entirely different behavior? If so, hit us up in the comments, because for now that seems more like a pile of rubbish to me. Next up is a fantastic question. Yay, thank you for that. We wanted to know whether one could use Pearson's correlation coefficient to actually disentangle the latent space of a neural network. Well, disentangling basically means that we want the latent of our neural network to be nice and tidy. For example, that an autoencoder of handwritten digits is actually split into different characteristics, like having one variable in the latent express thickness and the other variable in the latent expressing the number which is actually displayed. Sadly, an unregularized latent space isn't that cleaned up, and these characteristics are all over the place. Maybe we want a distribution where this latent space is nicely split into one variable having thickness and the other one containing the digits, all nice and tidy. But in truth, they are actually looking like this instead, with one variable having both characteristics in them a little bit. And that's just one possible way, but this is something we actually do not want for disentangled representation. What's important is that these variables are somewhat correlated in the latent space now, meaning that, for example, when we have some information about the x-axis, we also get some information about the y-axis as well. If we're on this part of the x-axis, we know that we can only be in this part of the y-axis. Now, throwing Pearson's correlation coefficient on the loss to enforce that from x we can no longer linearly extrapolate y would somewhat prevent that. But there are a whole bunch of issues with that. We would just prevent a linear correlation that Pearson's correlation coefficient measures, nothing more. Anything nonlinear is not really caught by that. And as these networks are really sneaky, they can just choose to hide these properties in some nonlinear fashion to circumvent that, still being all messy and entangled. And for the last part, let's now get to the juicy geometry. Regarding point clouds, there's a whole bunch of reasons why they are messy to work with. From these answers, the numbers of points is clearly not a problem. One could say that 128 points are actually all you need to see that this is a chair. Opposing to an amnesty image where you would have, for example, 28 by 28 pixels, and you'd already end up with 784 values. However, permutation invariance is a thing though. You don't have a canonical order of those points like you would have for images or voxels that are essentially just grids with values in them. To explain one of the ideas to get around that was already mentioned in the comments, thank you for that, let's go quickly over the idea of PointNet. You find the link to the well-written paper in the description box. The key idea is simple. Put the points through a function that is permutation invariant as well. For example, if we take the maximum of A, B, and C, that is the same as the maximum of B, C, and A. So maximum is a symmetric function. And that's what they are essentially using to become permutation invariant. Put all points through such a function. What they then do is they take every single point individually, apply a shared neural network to it to bloat it up, say to 1,000 dimensions, and then apply max pooling across every dimension, ending up with 1,000 maximum values that form your embedding of the input cloud. So by using this symmetric function, we got rid of the permutation sensitivity, while also not really caring how many points we actually put in here, because we always end up with 1,000 values. And this resulting embedding you can then process to, for example, classify whether the input model is a plane or a chair. Aside from permutation invariance, you have a bunch of other issues though. Not properly defined convolution operator, varying densities you'd get from a laser scanner, etc. And lots of more fun with geometry. And that's just the issues you have with point clouds. Triangle meshes are even worse if you ask me. So, thank you for staying with me until the end. If you have any cool suggestions for community questions, just send them and we will credit you. Hope to see you again.